Please turn your Bibles with me to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. I count it a privilege to be able to share the Word of God with you. It is my desire that God will, first of all, use His Word to bless and challenge my heart, and that He will also do that to you. I read verse 1 at the outset. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. When we talk about biblical eschatology, we are talking about that which brings everything to a final conclusion. As there is a beginning for everything, as is stated in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth.
Hey, that's Enoch. Yes. That's the man that pleases God. Who's that folk over there standing in the back like, oh, that's Enoch. He pleases God. Who's that folk getting on the bus? That's Enoch. He pleases God.
Thank you. but holding on.
Holding on to faith and hope.
Nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out. Can watch it does it now. But when it looks, but when it looks as if we can win, you wrapped us in, you wrapped us in your arms as empty. And everything you need, you supply. You got this in control. And now we know that you made. And you made a way when our backs were against the wall, and it looks as if it was over. You made a way, and we're standing here only. Was over you, Lord. Yes, you made a way, and we're standing here only because you made a way.
Curaçao is known for many things. What stands out is the friendliness of the people. They make you feel right at home, especially if you're a family friend. You can sense a feeling of pride that they have for their flag and island, that they want you to have the best experience ever. They're also known for their sea aquarium, where they have various sea animals on display, such as dolphins and seals. There is also the famous swing bridge, and you can walk on to get to the other side of the town in order to experience their various shopping sites. Their customer service is one of the best I've experienced in the Caribbean. Due to the pride of the flag, they produce a lot of athletes that will carry their flag on their sleeves. There are a few athletes that have made it in pro sport, such as soccer players, baseball players, swimmers, sprinters, and many more. So if you're pursuing a dream in sports, here is the place to go. Christianity is not as popular in Curaçao as it was in the past, but it is still present, and they respect your beliefs. There is even Little Curaçao, which is called Klein Curaçao, which is a small island which is still part of Curaçao and is just a boat ride away. Curaçao is a very nice tourist destination and an island to experience and to never forget.
Dominica, the nature island of the Caribbean, officially known as the Commonwealth of Dominica, is located between the French islands of Guadeloupe to the west and Martinique to the south. Its area is 305 square miles and has a population of more than 76,000, and its highest point is Mont Diablotin. Its official language is English. In addition, Dominica Creole and French Creole is widely spoken. Dominica was discovered on November the 3rd, 1492 by Christopher Columbus and got its independence as a republic in 1978. It is known for its natural environment and has the world's second largest hot spring called the Boiling Lake. If you love waterfalls, that's it. This is a place to spend a few days of your vacation this summer. The country is known for its unspoiled beauty because of its lush, mountainous rainforest, and it is the home of many rare plants, animals, and species. The Ciceru parrot, found only in Dominica, is the island's national bird and featured on the national flag. Dominica's rainforests, freshwater lakes, hot springs, waterfalls, and diving spots make it an attractive ecotourism destination. Talk about culture! Music and dance are important facets of Dominica's culture. The annual independence celebrations display a variety of traditional song and dance. Dominica, Dominica, Dominica. There is so much to see and do. Visit the nature island of the Caribbean today.
Located in the Windward Islands group of the Lesser Antilles is St. Vincent and the Grenadines. St. Vincent is 133 square miles, with a population of approximately 110,589 people. The capital city, Kingstown, is located on the southeast coast of the island. Scattered between St. Vincent and Grenada are more than 100 breathtaking small islands called the Grenadines, half of which belong to St. Vincent and the other half to Grenada. St. Vincent had been inhabited by the Carib Indians of South America for many years before it was discovered by Christopher Columbus in 1498. It is well known for its live volcano, La Soufriere, and its beautiful caves, emerald hills, botanical gardens, postcard-worthy beaches, and wonderful people. This Caribbean destination, with its many neighboring Grenadine islands, makes a perfect escape for the fun-loving and adventurous. Add St. Vincent to your list of amazing places to visit.
Weak and wounded, a sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. Sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. For remember when we walk, sometimes we fall. Fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. But if your skies are dark and pours the rain, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. And when you can't contain the joy inside, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus.
Pastor Adrian O. Messiah. Pastor Adrian O. Messiah is from the Gem of the Antilles, St. Vincent and the Grenadines. He's married to the lovely Jolene Messiah. They have been blessed with three wonderful children. He pastors at the Berean Baptist Church. The Berean Baptist Church has been around for 70 years and stands for truth in every corner. Now we will have Pastor Adrian O. Messiah.
Good evening to everyone. It's good to be able to share God's word with you. The topic before us today is the church unmoved in its witness. Church unmoved in its witness. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you again for the wonderful opportunity in sharing your word. We give you all the glory and praise for who you are. Please use me as only you can. Make me a vessel of honor fit for your use. I pray you may speak to me again and through me to all of us. May we understand the great responsibility that is before us in sharing the glorious gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May we be unmoved in doing just that. Take the control now. May your Holy Spirit enlighten us, illuminate our hearts and our minds. May we apply truth to our heart and to our lives, only for your honor and for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. Now, as we consider the church and move in its witness, the church and move in its witness, Paul, as he would write to Timothy, would say, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, in verse 1. Note verse 2. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as he left earth, in the Great Commission, said to his disciples to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Paul had a passion to preach the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Such was his passion. In the book of Romans chapter 1, we hear him say in verse 13, now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purpose to come unto you, but was led hitherto that I might have some fruit among you, also even as among other Gentiles. He says, I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are also at Rome. He says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Paul is expressing his great desire to preach the gospel. Paul understood quite clearly that he owed that to those of his audience. Whether you were a Greek, whether they are barbarians, whether they were wise or unknown, he's saying all men need the gospel. Why? Because the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. He understood quite clearly the benefits of the gospel and what it can do for lost sinners. So here, as you would now charge young Timothy to preach the word in season and out of season. There are many things that are present today that are able to move the church of the living God from being a witness in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. But as Paul would say to Timothy, preach the word in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all suffering and doctrine. In other words, Timothy, you have a job to do. Do not be fazed by the things around you. The challenges, yes, they are present and they will be there. But don't be a fool. Be a witness for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. From the verse that is before us, verse 2, he will say, preach the word. The truth, what should be preached? The word. The Bible is saying how the word is truth. And Paul is saying to Timothy, proclaim the truth. Not any word, but the word of God. In John chapter 17 and verse 17, we find Jesus Christ saying, sanctify them to thy fruit, thy word is truth. In John chapter 8 and verse 32, hear him say, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Therefore, Paul is saying to Timothy, proclaim the word of God or preach truth. And beloved, in these times, we need to preach nothing but the truth. Men need to be set free. Men need to hear the gospel. All they need to hear is nothing but the truth. So here he would say, as he helped this young pastor to preach, he would say to him, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. But when you're preaching truth, he would say you need to reprove, or you need to tell apart. If you and I are going to be honest with the word of God is, we must tell them the truth, we must tell them their faults, because all of us are faulty, we are full of faults, and we need to know where we are going wrong. Not only should we reprove or tell a fault, because we are all faulty. He says, rebuke, censure severely, charge them sharply. Or bring that person when they are in a fault and let them know, hey, you have strayed, you have gone astray. You need to get it right. Let them know that this will not be tolerated. Therefore, if you're going to live holy lives before Almighty God, there is a way to live according to God's standard and not according to your standard. Because it is very easy for every man to do what is right in his own eyes. So he says, reprove. Tell of all, tell them the truth. Rebuke them with the truth. But reach out with all long-suffering and doctrine. He would say, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. The word exhort here means to call men, to summon, to encourage. Hereby you're using the word of God. And with patience, the pure word of God, the unadulterated word of God, and you must tell them the truth. That in these times we're living in, men need to hear the truth. They need to be reproved. You must tell them their fault. You must censure them when they're going astray. But you must reach out with all patience and doctrine, letting them know the truth of God's word. Right. So proclaim the truth. But note, he would say, preach the word, be instant in season. This word instant is very interesting. This word instant means to stand upon, to be present, to be at hand. In other words, you must be present with the truth. Always be present to proclaim the truth of God's word. I know many times, and even today, because of all that is going on around us, many men of God and many witnesses of God, they are absent, they are moved by the things that are going on around. They cannot be found to share God's word. They cannot be found to share the truth. Are you available, I should ask, in sharing the truth of God's word? Are you present, or are you so concerned about what's going on around you that you forget to be at hand when someone needs to hear the truth of God's word? Therefore, he will tell him how to do this. If you come down to verse 5, he will say, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. I want to share with you how to be present with the truth. Watch in all things. Beloved, the things that we need to see, the things that are going on around us even today, that can easily move us from being present with the truth, that can easily move us from being witnesses of the truth. Remember, if the church is going to be unmoved and we are going to be its witnesses, we must always be present, always be at hand and ready to share the truth. And therefore, we must watch And today you find the destructive volcanoes and even storms. One is right in our country. Weeks ago exploding, erupting. Still, we must be present in sharing the truth. Right. Not too long ago, storms would have hit our islands. Deadly hurricanes causing so much damages. Were you present in sharing the truth?
Right.
Today, the pandemic is real. Deadly viruses haven't moved you in being present in sharing the truth. I'm aware that many people have locked the churches because of the regulations put in place. But how many of us are just taking a break from the ministry of God's word in sharing the truth? Of how many of us see that this is an important time where we must be present in sharing the truth? Therefore, if we are watching in all things, we will understand our great responsibility in sharing the truth. Yet the range of vanities that exist today, men are empty. The things that they're seeking for pleasure, they have no time for God. Are we present to share the truth of God's word? Demonic values exist today. Things have changed from what it used to be. The church must stand and move in its witness and letting man know that, listen, the world has a standard, but God's standard must be number one and the only standard that man must accept at all times. Demonic values is acceptable in society. Men with men, women with women, and they're changing their sex and all these kinds of stuff. We must be present in sharing the truth.
Right.
What does God say in His word? What should we preach? The truth. Demonic values lead, no doubt, to disobedient voices. Many are protesting against the truth of God's word. They will now tell you what God meant from what He means. They will now tell you what God said in His word from what He didn't say. We must be careful that we're not calling evil good and good evil. God's truth is absolute. And there are men who are trying to change the truth of God into a lie. Many of us must be present with the truth, ready to preach it and stand upon it. Let men know what truth really is. The truth of God's word. Preach nothing, my brothers and sisters, but the truth. Whether or not you're guilty of straying from the truth, men need to hear the truth. That's how men will be set free, only with the truth. Don't tell a lie. Don't tell them things to make them feel good. Be present with the truth. It doesn't matter if the whole world is tumbling around us. Let men know that there is refuge in Jesus Christ, because that is the truth. So he will say to young Timothy, watch in all things, endure afflictions. In this gospel ministry, we need to understand that afflictions are prominent in the life of the believer. In Psalm 24, verse 19, the psalmist will say, many are the afflictions of the righteous. You just can't escape it. Job tells us, man that is born of a woman in a few days, he is full of trouble. We need to understand that the man who lived godly in Christ will suffer persecution. It's prominent in the life of the believer. Therefore, we are called to persevere or undergo hardships when it comes to affliction. That's why Paul will say to Timothy, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ.
Right.
It's going to be rough at times. When you stand for truth, many people will stand against you. But still, you must stand for truth. Jesus Christ, in his early ministry, he preached the truth. They stood against him. Not many people love to hear the truth. You want to lose your friend? You tell them the truth. Therefore, we call to persevere, to endure hardness, afflictions, as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. He says, carry out the work of an evangelist. Preach nothing but the gospel, because it brings no shame. It's still sin. What men need to have is not a feel-good sermon. What men need to have is a glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, how he went to the cross of Calvary, how he died for their sins, and he can set them free. The truth of God's word. Be present with it to tell them. The church must be a witness in proclaiming the word and the truth. The church must be a witness. Be unmoved in prison, be present with the truth. As you watch, in all things, the things that are going on around us should not move us to end your afflictions. Carry out the act of an evangelist. The Apostle Paul went through so much in his early ministry, but he would say, none of these things move me, because he was present in sharing the truth of God's word. So if the church is going to be a move in its witness, the truth must be preached. The truth is the word of God. So he would say to young Timothy, preach the word. But note, he would say, be instant, in season, out of season. Remember, the word instant there means to be present with the word. Ready? In season, out of season. He's now speaking about the times.
Right.
The times in which the church should witness.
Right.
Therefore, we will share the word of God in season and out of season. If I had to call our minds to the season of the year, as we know them, we know of winter, don't you? It is usually cold in winter. That doesn't mean the child of God should take a vacation.
Right.
We should think of the cold-hearted generation that lies before us that needs a savior.
Right.
If we think of summer, which is usually hot, we should think that all men, they're hot in sin and they're heading to the hottest place, the imaginary, where their misery and torment, a place called the lake of fire. If we think of spring, that root of bitterness and sinfulness that rests in the hearts of men, that needs addressing. Therefore, we must see it as a responsibility so that men can be stopped from that root of sin, spirit of sin, from germinating. And if we think of fall, what a great fall in sin when men disobey God. And they're in need of the blood of Jesus Christ as the only remedy for salvation. But as Paul would say to Timothy, preach the word in season. I bring your attention to verse 3 of 2 Timothy chapter 4. He says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heed to themselves teachers having itching ears. Note, he will say, for the time will come. In other words, the time has not arrived as yet. And he's speaking futuristically. He's saying the time will come.
Right.
He's saying the time will come. Note, when they will not endure sound doctrine. Now, Paul is really saying here, Timothy, you are living in a time when right now they are enduring sound doctrine. They're listening to that which is sound.
Right.
The truth of God. Well, in other words, listen, I understand and know that the word of God is appreciated by them.
Right.
That's what he's saying there. So they appreciate the word of God. And that is an in-season time when men will come and they will listen to you. You will go and you will have street meetings. You will have meetings in the church. You will invite someone and they will come and they will sit and they will listen to the word of God. And God will even say to them, you don't even have to look for that.
Yeah.
In season time.
Yeah.
The preacher loves those times.
Yeah.
But note, he will also say, by implication, remember, he's saying the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. So right now, they enjoy the sound teachings of God's word. But he says, but after their own lust shall they heed to themselves teachers. There will come a time when they will after their own lust heed to themselves teachers. In other words, he said, right now, presently, the world is agreeable from the teacher or from the teachers they have. They appreciate the word of God. They are in agreement with their teachers. But a time will come when they will not agree with the teachers. So that's an in-season time when a preacher preached the word of God and the people in the audience, the sinners, understand what the preacher is preaching. They're looking at themselves and they're saying, oh me. They're not looking at another brother or sister. They're saying, I am in need of thee, dear Lord. That's what he said. Presently, they agree with the word of God. They're not passing it to another person. They're not fighting it. They're not challenging it. They accept the truth as the truth because they want to be set free. He's also saying right there in the verse, the time will come when they will have itching ears. In other words, Timothy, right now, they don't have itching ears. This is an in-season time. They don't have itching ears. There's going to come a time when they will have itching ears. But right now, they don't have itching ears. The word was against their own kind of nature. Saying right now, you're preaching the word. You're preaching the truth. You're reproving them. You're telling them their faults. You're censuring them sharply. You're reaching out to them, encouraging them to live after truth and to walk after truth and to live according to the truth. They appreciate what you're doing. They agree with you what you're doing. Hallelujah. The preacher is happy because the people are in sync with God's word. That's an in-season time.
Good stuff.
That's the present time. Along are the days when we used to sit in the audience, listen to the preacher, and we saw to ourselves, we appreciate what he said. We see ourselves in light of the word and we want to make changes. All is well in the Christian church. The people are sensitive to God's word. People are ready to hear God's word. You invite them, listen, they have a vigor. They have a zest inside of them. They have a zeal for God. They want to hear truth. They were there present on a Sunday morning. They were there present on a Sunday evening. They were there present on a Wednesday night. You call them Thursday and Friday. They were there to worry because they love to hear the truth of God's word. In season times, you call them to go and witness. They were ever present because they love truth and love to share the truth. But note, the out of season time. And he's telling Timothy these times will come, and I'm afraid that these times are now upon us. These times are upon us, even today. As Paul would have said, Timothy, the time will come. I am saying that the time is ahead. He says, for the time will come, but not their head, when they will not endure sound doctrine. The neglect of the pure teachings of God's word. But too many of us want to be on the side of people.
Right.
We want too many friends. We want to be identified. We want to be well known. We want to be popular. We want to know that, listen, we have many followers instead of standing and following the truth of God's word. I tell you, when you take a stand for God, you take a stand for truth, not many friends you will have. I know there are many people who will say, well, you are free to believe what you want to believe, but can I say this to you? There is one truth according to the word of God, and the Bible is clear that God is not the author of confusion. And a man, listen, who will not follow the truth of God's word, the Bible is clear, you mark them which cause division and you avoid them. But I keep hearing Many so-called Christians say, well, you're free to believe what you believe. Mm-hmm. And I am free to believe what I believe. We can still fellowship together. Mm-hmm. Truth is truth.
Right.
Truth set men free. And therefore there is one truth. That's why the Bible tells us, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Therefore, listen, we must take truth seriously and share the truth of God's word. Stand on it. Fight for it. That's very, very important. The times ahead, as Paul will say to Timothy, the time will come where they will neglect the pure teachings of God's word. Doctrine is important. The truth of God's word is important. He would also say to him, not only will he not endure some doctrine, but after the old loss, shall he to himself teach us. And we're living in times as these, where many people can just turn on their devices. And a preacher from Timbuktu is on. They don't have to know the preacher. But as you listen to the preacher and what he has to say, you would know if he's preaching the truth of God's word. But too many of us, we don't like to hear the truth. We don't like how the preacher is preaching because he's not telling you what you want to hear. He's telling you the truth. And the truth indeed hurts. The word of God is powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword. It is able. And listen, it pierces the heart of man. And man is hurt. He's wounded by truth. But I listen, it is better to be wounded by truth than to be wounded by lies. That's why the Bible says, faithful are the wounds of a friend. And therefore, we must understand that it is not what we want to have, but it's what God says in his word. And therefore, we must apply and do it. So they have plenty teachers these days, they have plenty preachers. Or their pastor is not enough, they have to go on the television because this television man or preacher, he is my preacher too. And how many preachers do you want? How many pastors do you want? And they're all preaching a different truths. Remember, there is only one truth that is found in God's word. But your preacher is not telling you what you want to hear. So they nourish themselves with pleasurable teachings. I have to go home now and listen to this one because I need an encouraging word today. When God would have said to you and to the preacher, you need to hear that which is to correct you. You need to identify your faults. You need to see where you're going wrong. You need to live according to the truth. Therefore, if the church is going to be unmoved in its witness, we must always proclaim the truth. Reprove, tell a fault. Rebuke, censure evil. Reach out with all long-suffering and doctrine. Being patient where that is concerned. Watching all things. The things around us are there to distract us and prevent us from sharing the truth. Viruses, volcanoes, vanities, values of men, disobedient voices, these things should not prevent us from being present in sharing the truth. Too many people are abandoning truth even at this time because of what is going on around us. Endure afflictions. The ministry is tough, it's challenging. Don't give up. Faithful is he that calleth you. Undergo hardship. Paul did that. He survived. Carry out the work of an evangelist. Preach the gospel. It brings no shame. It saves men. People still need the Lord. The times when we should preach is very important. In and out of season. There was a time when the church was filled, when people were present. You invite them, they would come. You can sit, you can have a good service. No distractions, no interruptions, no social distancing. You can shake hands and you can hug each other in season time. Church was a good place to be.
Right.
Now all kind of excuses.
Mm.
All kind of distancing. Out of season time.
Mm.
Still we have a responsibility not to neglect the pure teachings of God's word.
Mm.
Or stick to teachers and preachers of truth.
Mm.
Not to nourish yourself with pleasurable teachings.
Right.
Because you want to hear what you want to hear. Because we must understand and know that if we fail in our witnesses, being a witness for Almighty God, that we are failing as a church. The Apostle Paul was mindful of that. That he would say to young Timothy, Timothy, I need for you to understand something. I'm charging you to do all this to preach the word. I am now at the end of my journey. And as he concluded, he would say to him, for I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand, in verse 6. He says to Timothy, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Timothy, I want you to understand, I was there preaching the gospel. In season and out of season. There were times when I faced perils, but I still hold on to the word of God. I was present to preach truth. Hey, Timothy, preach the word. In season, whether you feel like it or you don't feel like it, preach the word. Preach truth. So as you reflect on his life, he says, listen, I have fought a good fight. I did my job. Timothy, you know something? There's a reward that lies ahead for me. He says, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, oh, he's judging us. And if we are unmoving our witness, he's taking note. We are failing because people still need the Lord. He's saying he shall give me at that day, not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearance. Hey, Timothy, preach the word. Be instant in season. And out of season, preach nothing but the word. I encourage you, my brothers and sisters, to be witnesses, even in these challenging and hard times and difficult times. Our mandate as Christians is to share the glorious gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with men. We should not be unmoved as a witness for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Please be encouraged to continue to preach nothing but the word of God. Lord, we thank you so much for your holy and precious word. May we take that to heart and preach truth, be present at all times in sharing it. In season and out of season, doing what you have called us to do. We give you all the glory and the praise for your precious word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.